expensive present for the airplane.
So I didn't know if there was something that didn't Well, if you can give us some reason, not in the minutes back there.
I said things, Joe.
It just comes through like that. I have no idea.
This is the closest to it.
Okay.
You want an extra for the other test?
Any other changes that you're seeing? So we need a motion to adopt the corrections.
Yeah.
Motion's been made seconded to adopt the corrections. Will we start with something there?
Chip.
Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. Next item, we have a public hearing. I'm going to call a public hearing to order at 7:15. This is for Branch Brook Fuel, a conditional use application. A proposal to install a bulk oil storage facility consisting of three 20,000 gallon number two fuel tanks and one 10,000 gallon kerosene storage tank in an existing fuel storage depot located at 14 Old Sawmill Road, tax map 36, lots 15 and 23 in the DB2 district. Branch Brook Fuels and the owner, John Hughes, is the applicant's agent. Is there anybody here from the public that has any questions for Mr. Hughes or Branch Brook? Okay, so I'm going to wait for at least 1 minute, because we should have some time for a moment. That works. It took me about a minute to do this. But hearing no debate, I will call the public hearing to a close at 7:11. So that's 7:16, sorry. I don't even like 7. Pending application. Item number one, Branch Brook Fuel. A conditional use application. Proposal to install a bulk oil storage facility consisting of three 20,000 gallon number two fuel tanks and one 10,000 gallon kerosene storage tank in an existing fuel storage depot located at 14 Old Sawmill Lane, tax map 36, lots 15 and 23 of the DB2 district. Branch Brook Fuels is the owner and John Hughes is the applicant agent. Does the board have any questions?
Thank you.
Do you have any other things that you want to ask? Comments, questions?
No, I'm not going to change.
There is nothing from the board.
I've got a couple of questions about the findings of fact, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
The appropriate time.
Yes.
To raise those. Okay. In the findings of fact, number 9. In the event that the applicant bends a sheen upon the surface fluid, but in the containment dike, the applicant shall dispose of the accumulated runoff via licensed waste hauler, contract, Buck Creek, and or dispose of oil and water mixture in accordance with the state prior requirements. Shouldn't that also include Department of Environmental Protection regulations? What happens when it's done with that water, that contaminated water, is regulated by the
To the applicant, would the fire marshal have anything that would help?
I think so. Right. No, I think the, it's Clean Harbors or something like that, they're regulated by the DEP. And they have the answer once it goes into their truck, and they have custody of it.
But and the DEP would then go ahead and put it to the if it fell into that category.
It's an industrial waste order.
So I would say in accordance with the state Department of Environmental Protection regulations.
Okay.
that if they want, and trigger some other land use regulation, which, based on their standards, they have.
Anything else? As we go through, if there's something comes up, let me know. Findings of fact and motion for approval, Grand Brook Fuel Bulk. Fuel bulk oil storage facility. Whereas on March 23rd, 2017, the Columbia Planning Board received a conditional use permit application from DNR Leasing Company Incorporated to a bulk oil storage facility consisting of 3 20,000 gallon number 2 fuel tanks and 1 12,000 gallon kerosene storage tank. In an existing fuel storage depot located at 14 Old Cromwell Lane, Tax Map 36, blocks 15 and 23 in the DB2 district. I thought you were talking about a 10,000 gallon kerosene tank this entire time.
It interchangeably goes back and forth. Yeah. Bay Corner, some of it says 10, some of it says 12.
Is it 10 or 12? The back says 12.
Yes.
Thank you. Whereas on April 13th, 2017, Planning Board conducted a sidewalk at the proposed project site, whereas on June 22nd, 2017, the Planning Board adopted a formal conditional use application from DNR Leasing Company Incorporated and determined the application completed in accordance with Land Use Ordinance Section 10.6.3.2. Whereas on July 13th, 2017, the Planning Board conducted a public hearing in conformance with the Land Use Ordinance Section 10.6.3.3. And whereas the Arundel Planning Board has determined the following findings of fact and those of decision. Findings of fact number one, the owner of the property is DNR Leasing Company Incorporated, and John Hughes is the applicant's agent. Number two, the property is located at 14 Old Sawmill Lane, Tax Map 36, Lots 15 and 23 of the DB2 District. Number three, the property currently contains a 30,000 gallon propane storage and distribution facility, 20,000 gallon oil tank serviced by an overhead loading ramp on a concrete pad, and 5,000 gallon diesel tank. Number four, the applicant proposes to construct 3 20,000 gallon single wall vertical wall oil storage tank and 1 12,000 gallon vertical kerosene tank that would dispensed by the existing loading ramp. Number five, a concrete container bag measuring 37 feet by 38 feet shall be constructed around the four vertical tanks with sufficient capacity to contain the entire contents of a ruptured 20,000 gallon tank, plus a 10% additional volume of liquid to account for rainfall in a 25-year storm. Number six, a container bag shall contain a stormwater collection sump in the northeast corner of the dike for collecting precipitation to be regularly pumped from the containment facility by a portable pump and discharged from the existing drainage swale located on the north side of Sawmill Road. Runoff from the swale will be discharged to the east into the wooded area via a level spread. Number seven, the discharge end of the pump will be fitted with an ultra-absorbent sump that will filter out residual oil to the containment area. Number eight, the applicant shall remove all accumulated snow from the containment dike within 24 hours of the end of a snowstorm event totaling more than 6 inches, and any time the accumulation of snow exceeds 6 inches. Number nine, in the event that the applicant notes a sheen upon the surface of fluid in the containment dike, the applicant shall dispose of the accumulated runoff via a licensed waste hauler contracted to collect, treat, and or dispose of the oil and water mixture in accordance with Maine State Department of Environmental Protection regulations. Number 10, in addition, the applicant is proposing to construct a 12-foot by 47-foot concrete deck to the east of the tank farm for the loading for product from tankers into the four vertical tanks. Number 11, no additional lighting is proposed to be installed. Number 12, the applicant proposes to install 6 8-foot tall arborvitae trees. Words I can't pronounce. That word there. Along the property line of the adjacent office building on Lot 2, Tax Map 36, Lot 15A, to screen the plant from the neighboring property. the existing pine tree stand along the southern boundary will screen the tank, will screen the tank farms on the neighbors to the south, while the existing vegetation and branch building will help screen the tank from the retail shop located on lot 16. Number 13, stormwater analysis reveals there will be no increase in the peak runoff generated by the activity, with most runoff collected within its containment type. Number 14, record plans showing all proposed site improvements include sheets C101 and sheet 301 as prepared by St. Germain Collins dated June 6, 2017 with revisions to 6-8-2017 and property survey of the old sawmill subdivision prepared by Lower Village Survey prepared January 8, 2010. Conformance with conditional use criteria. After due review and consideration of the planning board determined the application to be in conformance with the criteria of section 929 of the Arundel Land Use Ordinance as follows. 9291, that the use is compatible with and similar to the general categories of uses of neighboring properties. The proposed use is a permitted conditional use in the DB2 district and is consistent in scale and use with other uses in the surrounding neighborhood and district.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded for 9291. Any discussion? Hearing none, those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. 9292. The use is consistent with the comprehensive plan and the anticipated future development of the neighborhood in that the comprehensive plan specifies fuel services to be appropriate in and the use is consistent with the long-range plan for the DB district to serve as a model for their business. Hearing none, those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. 9293, that there is adequate safe pedestrian and vehicular access to and into the site to accommodate anticipated traffic to and from the neighborhood. The proposed use will not generate unreasonable trip generation, and the proposed plan will reduce pedestrian vehicle conflicts on the property. No changes are proposed to occur to driveway access or internal circulation. Motion's been made and seconded for 9292. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. 9294, that there is adequate water supply and sewage disposal available to service the use. The proposed use will not require septic or water service. A high flow fire hydrant approved by the Arundel Fire Rescue Department is located 200 feet west of the tank farm on Old Sawmill Lane.
So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for 9294. Any discussion? Yes, Joe.
Question. I just had to follow up. I presume there are facilities in the office building for employees?
I hope so.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah.
Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Yes. Aye.
It is unanimous. 9295, that there will be no noise, dust, odor, vibration, or smoke generated by the use that will adversely affect neighboring properties in that. Noise, dust, and smoke. The nature of the business does not generate any undue noise, dust, or smoke generation outside of the structure. Okay. Motion's been made and seconded for 9295. Any discussion? Hearing none, those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. 9296, that the physical characteristics of the site, including location, slope, soils, drainage, and vegetative cover, are suitable for the proposed use. The proposed use will require little alteration of the existing site topography. Tree cover will be retained on the perimeter of the site. Existing stormwater facilities will be adequate to accommodate the proposed runoff generated by the activity. Second. Okay. Motion has been made and seconded for 9296. Any discussion?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Sorry, question. Existing stormwater facilities, I thought that that swale was being expanded or something. Okay, never mind.
nuisance. No nuisances will be generated by the proposed use. The applicant proposes to install an 8-foot-high vegetated buffer along the western property line between the use and existing commercial uses on lot 15A. So moved.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded for 9297. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? It is unanimous. 9298, with all other requirements and applicable provisions of this ordinance, particularly any pertinent conforming standards are met. The applicant has met all pertinent portions of the other land use ordinance in the design of the proposed activities. So
second.
Motion been made and seconded for 9298. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Yes.
Therefore, be it resolved that based on the above findings and conclusions, the Arundel Planning Board hereby approves the conditional use application of DNR Leasing Company Incorporated to a bulk oil storage facility consisting of 3 20,000-gallon number 2 fuel tanks and 1 12,000-gallon pedestal storage tank in an existing fuel storage depot located at 14 West Sawmill Lane, Tax Map 36, Lots 15 and 23 in the DB2 district, subject to the following conditions. Number one, no construction shall commence until the applicant presents the code enforcement officer and town planner with a permit of approval from the Maine State Fire Marshal. Number two, all soil erosion control devices shall be installed prior to the commencement of construction and shall be maintained in good working order for the duration of the construction process. Number three, no certificate of occupancy shall be issued by the Arundel Code Enforcement Officer until the town planner presents a letter bearing the seal of the design engineer certifying that all improvements have been completed in accordance with the approved plans and disposition of use permit, so approved by the Arundel Planning Board this 13th day of July 2017. Motion and second.
Motion.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the application for Branch Brook Fuels. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
It is unanimous. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any corrections?
Preparing an application for the town. I heard at the last meeting that, that your engineer or agent is not going to be able to make the decision.
I'll leave that another.
Okay. I would suggest that he get in touch with the town planner. And much the same way that we just had the conditions of approval for Branch Brook, you'll have the same list of criteria that you have to go through the meeting. In addition, look, Marty, was there anything at the sidewalk that, that you would like to address to Mr. Stephan?
No, I didn't see anything from Shay.
Okay.
I mean, the only thing you don't kind of want to be is also is list what vehicles that will be used in my backyard.
Make sure that the areas, all the areas that we have any kind of paper put in are noted on the plan and sort of use in your determination to set that in line. So
the biggest issue that I saw was in the back corner, as you stand on set on the road, I'm still looking to face the property in the back. They like to mark out the roads. That's an awesome close to that. Or you need to make sure that you're not encroaching on that one.
But I did have a self-fence edge, and then when DEP, you know, was kind of rotted for all the years. And then she gassed me, put stump grounds in. And I did that the next day.
Yeah, but this was the corner itself.
Yeah,
because it looked like. But I believe I don't want to check the setbacks and make sure that that's not supported. Again, that's the fellow that's going to be doing the plans for you. You have to work all of that up. You're going to have to go get a complete application. The question is, I have to report it, whether or not it's certain.
Beneficial
to have some sort of plan prepared, at least to document the existing conditions of the site in the long term.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
My.
He's here at the board.
Yeah, over.
I'm sure about that.
Okay, then yes, we would like to have it on paper showing us where everything is, showing us the boundaries and survey boundaries.
Yeah. You want this boundary on a button land?
Yes.
Okay.
So that you can see what that distance happens to be. So on that plan, you'll have to acquire the one, but you'll also have where you're placing all of your equipment.
Right.
Give a site distance, where property is.
I'm sure that the fellow that you're working with, I'm sure he knows what it is that he's going to have to put all of that together.
Yes.
Our information is better than us.
Right.
Yes.
So if you want all this request to serve in the site, you put on all conditions, because the existence of conditions.
Yes. You have that, when you first get there, you have the trailer that has...
Yeah.
You put, I don't know if you put some kind of skirting on that,
I put some ladders for it, which I can't do. But it's just storage for...
But just the entire, you can clean it up a little bit.
Yeah.
Some feedback. That's great. We're here to hear it. But the next meeting, as
saw clear will be what Mr. Hughes went through at the last hearing that I was at in June. He went through it, it was the actual application was presented as well. Okay. And just on that topic, Mr. Chairman and board members, look at the presentation of Branch Brook Fuels as well. Very professional. It's a question about a survey. It asked for everything you needed. They have professionals here. My point is, if you have a gentleman here who's under two consent decrees by the selectmen, and I know the selectman is here tonight on behalf of the board, this application should require a higher level of scrutiny even than Mr. Hughes is required. Honestly, the only scrutiny that we can give, what does the ordinance say?
That
maybe has to be same rules and that
when that's all about each
other. Right. Well, yeah, I think you've made it very clear to Mr. Sullivan, he's got to satisfy all this before he gets a waiver from the board. I just wanted to say to the board, every single resident in this neighborhood, and you will hear from us when you decide on the criteria about if it's compatible with the neighborhood. I think you know what we're going to say on that. Yeah. Ms. Hurley, this is a public hearing, I understand that. However, it's very important to give us all the information so you can make an informed decision. Is this use fit in this neighborhood? So, I really ask the board to very carefully consider any waivers. I know you're giving your feedback, we'll come back and then you'll decide on the waivers at the next meeting. But I want to lay the groundwork that we want to see a thorough presentation and the governance piece that Mr. Bassett just brought up is critical. I mean, we already had a 20,000 gallon tanker in there. We'll show you an aerial of that tanker in the next public hearing. You saw it briefly at the last year. There's a history here.
I understand that there is a history here. However, the Board of Selectmen superseded everything that came prior to this hearing. They entered into a consent decree with the applicant. All we can do is look at it and say, that's all been addressed by the Board of Selectmen. We now have to look at this application and say, does this application fit the criteria? Does he do what is required to do? And if he does, then the question becomes, does he get a permit?
I agree with you. And I'd like to be heard briefly on the selectmen's piece. At the last meeting, there was discussion on, gee, we've got to get this through quickly, selected and given Mr. Stoll for 60 days. Now, read the consent decree, you have a selectman here in the audience. The consent decree says Mr. Stoll had to apply the next day, because it was the day before the town meeting where the ordinance changed, okay? So we're operating under the ordinance. That's all well and good. The consent decree doesn't say, nor could it say, planning board, you have to suspend your rules, you have to rush this through. It doesn't say that. It only says if Mr. Stolten doesn't get his permit in 60 days, then fines can apply, not fines, but can. So if Mr. Stolten doesn't get his permit because you're taking a thorough look at this, you can go back, presumably, to the slide and say, look, I'm diligently before the board. What I'm saying is, let's not cry in the ear here for Mr. Stolten on that issue. It's not your issue.
I am not a lawyer. I'm not going on TV. My understanding of the consent decree is that he had 60 days to get an application to us. And I, that's what I looked at and that's what I saw. He has an application to us. It will take us as long as it takes us to work through. If he gives us a complete application, the way your expert did, it will go through smoothly, it will go through quickly. If it is not complete, we've got applications taking years.
Okay, great. We're on the same page. That's what I wanted to be saying. Because there's no reason that under the decree, I have to agree, under the decree or otherwise, for you guys to suspend your rules. I'm glad you're here to say
that. We don't suspend the rules, but we don't have a choice.
Right. We have selectmen that don't have the authority to do it, and I don't think they intend to do it. But if it gets to a point where he's beyond his 60 days, as a consensus, he says that's Mr. Stolten's problem. Go back to selectmen. So we're all on the same page.
Yep.
So the next meeting will be an application meeting similar to the one we saw Mr. Hughes put on in June.
Correct. He needs to put together the application, submit the application, and then come back. The meeting on that application will take place at the, there's a 14-day period. So he could not conceivably be on for July 27th. The earliest he could make it would be July 10th. Because that's assuming if he had everything together tomorrow morning at 9 a.m., he couldn't get on before August 10th. Because we have a 14-day requirement before we will put anything on the agenda.
So 14, in other words, you have to have everything from the applicant in your hands 14 days at that time?
Correct.
And that's available to the public?
Yeah. Is it available to the public?
I'm assuming it's going to get submitted. We get to look at this because the whole point of this process is for the public, for my clients, to be able to take a look at what you submitted and give you guys reasonable feedback based upon our living in the neighborhood. So, okay. Thank you for your time. That's all I really wanted to express.
Quite welcome. Any questions, Mr. Stilton? We will move on to item number 3. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Just a torment, please. You don't wear it in the audience or like outside of here with your friends, but on the planning board, or the board will send me. I'm wearing it.
Storage issues about lighting in their offices. The client did do a lighting plan, but Jay and Mike for the parking area, and the group is at phase two, and they do have a copy of that. That was really, you know, the more important part of the whole project. We're looking at the site at a small little, I think, 37 watt LED wall packs. That picture will be very small, just over the door. Small one here, the door, basically just for safety, you know, it's been very, very visualized, shielded. So very minimal lighting, you know, guys, this entire building is coming out. You're supposed to know that. There's a spot right here, street light, I don't know what spot, but it's more street light coming down to the rough security. There's also a street light here, coming down on that building, the security. So all the rest of the lights, I'm not a gas expert, so maybe I don't start with solving the question. I think John had told you about the, John had some told you about how we actually constructed, but again, it's underground, it's not something you actually physically look at. And I think we showed those what happened.
Follow up on Richard's point though, Paul, just for clarification, that Champagne was aware when either they constructed the line or whoever constructed the line, areas that were going to be paved versus areas that were going to remain unpaved. To sort of do the construction based on what surface conditions were going to exist.
Absolutely. They were totally aware of it.
Obviously, the plan showed paved areas. It showed gas lines there at that time, so.
Right. Originally, there weren't gas lines there because the tanks were going to be up front. Right. And that was the concern I had, because now the gas lines run right through a driveway, or well, not driveway, but a section where vehicles will cross over. And I'm more concerned with, is there enough underground surface so that the vehicles will not rupture the gas lines. That's the issue that I was looking for from Champagne, that they would say, yes, that is sufficient. Because otherwise, if they rupture the gas lines, it won't be a bang.
May I comment on that?
Yes, please.
They absolutely are aware of it. They installed everything, piping, asked all the pertinent questions, and I did exactly what they wanted. It's buried very significantly with sand at the proper depth to further review and guidance, and they use the appropriate product for the situation. They had no problem making that statement. At our last meeting, I called them up and they didn't hesitate to write that letter.
I guess the concern that I share with the chairman is that at the time that Champagne was installing the gas lines, we don't know whether the areas that eventually got paved, that was conveyed to Champagne, or that Motorland had even decided that they were going to do that at the time Champagne actually did the gas line. That's the concern is that if Champagne is looking at the plans as we approved last year, there are areas that are now paved and going to be used for particular traffic, which did not appear on those plans.
The only area that light shaded additional section right here, and you maintain the same depth all the way through. And they knew Peter, I forget his last name, the supervisor there, you know, intimately what we're talking about, the long range plan here. There's no problem with it.
I mean, I have to assume, when you're in front of this line, there's access to it here, and there's access to it here. He had to have some aware that he was putting a line that's going to be driven over.
I mean, and to your point, there was not like any kind of significant variation in depth of material throughout, you know, what was considered to be what was previously approved to be paved versus the areas that weren't.
Correct. And like last time, I have it on the iPad to show you pictures of the entire trench if you want to look at them again.
Through the chair, I was under the impression that we had a question, an analysis of the total impervious area.
I heard it.
Have you received that?
Not yet. If we haven't received it. I was looking for two specific items. One, the total impervious
The other one, I was looking for something specific to the fact that on the original approved plan, that was simply gravel. You laid the gas lines accordingly. I was looking for something from Champaign that specifically addresses the fact that now that there are vehicles going over, it is not going to impact that gas line. And it may not. The reference in this letter is referenced at FPA 54 and 58, but I don't know what an FPA 54 and 58 are. They may very well be something that says, yes, he can drive a vehicle over there and it will not cause any kind of defect in the equipment. That's what I was looking for.
Well, if it helps any, he's driven this big propane tank back here probably four times since it was installed.
How deep is the construction on that?
The trench itself is 30 inches.
So the trench is only 2.5 feet down. It's not even below frost
level. I don't think it's required to be past 2 feet.
It may not be. My concern was it may be 2 feet if one is going to have his pedestrian traffic. From a vehicular point of view, what's the impact? And that's what I wanted to find out from Champaign. Does that create a problem with the deck? Not did it meet the condition of the plan. I wanted to know whether or not it causes a problem. If I take this pumper truck out through there, it might cause a problem. I don't know.
Paul, do you know the spec on the gas lines? Yes.
I don't think that. That's 54, I can't get it.
I think, minimal compared to what we're talking about here. And as you know, pavement disperses the load factor considerably.
I do, and it may be. And that's, again, I don't know what 54 or 58 say. I was looking at something specific. Yes, Jason.
Just looking up online, FPA 54. Provides minimum safety requirements for the design and installation of fuel gas piping systems in homes and commercial buildings. That's 54.
Okay.
I'll try to get you 58.
Okay. Yeah, I would think that there must be something that talks about it going underneath vehicular access.
In a lot of circumstances, you would have paved section, cross section of what was going on, depth versus an unpaved section. And then the paved section would be designed to accommodate a certain particular loading. That might be typical around.
That may be what
most common vehicle, not withstanding pumper trucks or ATV or anything.
Yeah.
I do. Asphalt section is more for an airport, much different than asphalt section for a residential road.
Yep.
Right?
Much different. It doesn't tell me anything, but it does reference NFPA standards.
That being said, I am very curious. It was at 2.99 for impervious surface before you started doing work. And now you've paved over other stuff, so I fail to understand how you can still be at 2.99.
This area is all gravel, it's in gravel, pavement, gravel, all the way down, back to existing, impervious area, grade, back in 72.99 acres of board sidewalk. It's doing, and all the improvements are located on that original 2.99 impervious area. DEP requires if you're redeveloped properly, you have to start counting what you're redeveloping. So, because it does change the flow pattern, so even though you have 2.99 acres of impervious, you don't need to change the flow pattern of the impervious area. Probably okay. You just have to repaint it, you're not in shape and change the question. But if you're going to redevelop properly, there's about to trigger things like 45 square feet of water change. So I did that in February 9th, I estimated, back in 2017, and also another letter that produced that we did actually phase two. This one incorporates phase three, which added more impervious area here, which I did that, but I think we come back and forth for that at that time when we just got the violation. So the phase one, we built that building and added some new impervious area. So we had some cooling and paving that cost about $200 square feet. We added phase two, which is the building now is located over the existing impervious gravel area. Taking in the building phase two is $12 square feet, plus additional paving phase two, which is a new area anymore. Probably a walkway. I didn't include phase three, but I thought we were going to have it. Track of all the redeveloped areas, still all existing impervious area that was there. So we're not adding new pavement beyond what was there. We're adding new pavement on what existing.
Oh, I have a question. Was your surface system was over here? It wasn't impervious surface. The original pavement surface was created. I mean, this was all grass. And this was all grass.
It's all flat.
Originally, it was referred to
grass. When he looked at that, it was still my calculation back in the device and the calculation. It was gravel originally.
Right, but then it converted into a grass surface.
Some grass surface.
Yeah, when it converted to grass surface, if they used it for something.
No, and it doesn't, I guess, really matter to account my new encourage that is still less than 40,000 feet. I haven't created any more 40,000 feet, new redeveloped area. So, by the way, the post of people for our calculations, yes, we took that consideration of whether it was gravel or lawn, because there was some discussion back there, whether it was gravel versus some lawn, also a good change, or just the certain side of some of the grass. So, we did keep trying to get those calculations as the project was progressing. We're at probably 33,000 square feet right now.
33,000 of?
Because I'm not adding this section.
Okay.
This space.
Building and
pavement.
And pavement.
Redeveloped paved area.
Right.
Do you have the sun closer to your own back? Because I didn't see
them. I didn't read the sun closer to the stream. way over the design of the road. All I did was run calculations to Carver, decided Carver was going to work, and they did. So pretty much we made both there on 2 minutes size of the control board.
So Paul, you're saying that the 24 over.
Yeah, 24 over.
Okay.
24 barely worth of 25 milligrams.
Yep.
And then it's not reaching the top of the berm.
But that being said, 24 inch culvert would have carried 25 year storm, thereby 2 foot open channel.
Oh, would have rusted. And I didn't bother calculating the 50 year event, the 25 year event, looking at the 25 year event, the 24 inch culvert. That's that already just above reaching the bank.
Yep.
And the right.
What's the plan now for the water tower pump? It's not a pump. On the side of the engine.
Correct. What's the plan for it?
What's the plan?
Like, with the plans. I think there was some sort of concession part of the one that we're going to have on. Now, I think what I answered with regard is even with the pump not being built, everything was working fine. The water wasn't coming off the property, the water was coming off the roof, going into small space, full access to the structure. Even without building on, in his opinion, even the rain pump was working fine. I don't think we ever had any intention not to build that water plant, although we just thought it was working fine. However, the river is struggling right now, it's just coming to the evaporating on it. Depends upon being built.
future question. Where are we supposed to be?
We've got to come up with some kind of process that we go through. It's
says, no, this is what you asked us to do. We want you to do what you asked us, because we entered into a contract with you to do something specific, gave you our blessing, and then you changed everything that you wanted to do and came back to us after the fact, saying, oh, forgive us. Almost as if you were 16 and you were going, it's easier to ask for forgiveness than it is permission. So I don't have to go to your daddy and ask you for permission to take the car. I have to ask you for forgiveness for having taken the car. And that is the way that the planning board is starting to feel in a lot of cases, because you guys aren't the only ones that have done it. We see time after time.
But I'm not covering the ducks.
I wasn't involved in that.
No, and that's why, you know, it's not aiming at you guys, but it is
well,
what
we agree.
I know it happens, you know, that they're in at the moment, construction's there, they have time to say, well, let's stop, let's make a free lift, let's call it here, I got to stay 14 days ahead, I missed the deadline by one day, now I'm 28 days out, before I get in front of the board, it's 2 months out, these guys are not prepared for gas, I'm going to change my picture for gas, I'm saying, wow, we can't wait 2 months, we don't get to the building, you know, it's pressure on their end too, and not that I mean it's right, but
that's the point. When you come to us and you say, we spend months and we come up with an agreement to do something, and then we find out that you guys didn't honor your word, it's not worth the paper that this is printed on. It leads me to the question, why should we give you a permit to do it, other than the fact that we're nice people and we would like to have the business built out? You know, but at what point do we as a planning board stop and say enough of this? And we're at that point. We're talking about revoking permits for people because they consistently don't do what they have said they're going to do. In this case, we've been working with it, we're going through. There's still a couple of things, and I'm not sure how the rest of the board feels about it, but I would like to have a peer review on this entire project.
I still want someone to certify that there is less than 3 acres of impervious surface.
And that would be part of the peer review that we go through and we would say, here, here's certification. Our guides are now telling us that there are those 3 acres.
I don't agree with that at all. I think all there's an obligation to his state license to provide us with accurate information.
Not just
Paul, to that point though, what I think would be beneficial would be if there was a, where you have the lot coverage areas broken down on the plan, is to include and something on there that sort of formalizes that existing gravel surface or somehow substantiates that calculation.
I think other phases and the first phase we had that, second phase it changed, so this phase was
But they have it laid out on the plan. You're going to seal on the plan, that type of thing. Here's how it breaks out. You've got, you know, existing pavement, you know, proposed pavement, whatever, however you want to do it, to then substantiate that 2.9. I said all along I didn't have an issue with the door.
accommodated it with sort of splitting the detention basin in the rear and accommodating pedestrian access in an emergency situation? I don't have any more to add.
Should we formalize that? No, that's quite, that's what I want to know. Should we formalize that with a vote? Is it required?
I think it's all in form.
Like I said, when I came back and reputed my thing, okay, that's part of the building. The building is not, design of the building and the faces is not part of the plan. That's where I decided I was wrong by making a mistake about the door.
Okay.
We're going to formalize this at some point in a vote, you know, that encompasses other things that have been changed on the plan.
I want to jump ahead. Phase four?
No, it's still phase two. It's still phase two. Amendment to phase two.
You have already said that you plan on coming back with submissions for changes.
They still would like to come back in the future to landscape this area and use it for come up with new use for additional use. So we have to have a landscape plan.
But isn't there a proposed change?
That's the submission. Is it just trying to get this thing up to the
Okay. I was just curious.
The recreation, I thought there was a proposal to change the entire structure for a recreational showroom. Whatever the language was, it would be a museum.
Yeah, not a museum. But that's what I was curious about. But at this point, we need to look at this plan.
This is just to bring a plan back out of compliance, okay. So that hopefully we can move forward.
And we can put this on for public hearing. August 10th? Which, what are we doing on the...
And the 27th.
We can put on the 27th, we can do a public hearing on this.
On what?
On the Asbill.
On the Asbill.
So you're not ready to move for the public hearing? No. So the public hearing is scheduled for when?
The 27th. And barring no uproar from the public requiring major changes, we should be able to proceed forward.
Specific change that you make the plan prior to July 27th? Any specific changes that I have to make?
And the addition to change that's on the plan?
The notes.
The notes would be impervious calculations.
And you have a question on here. You have box trailer to be removed from weapons.
It's already done.
Okay, I was going to say, please tell me it's not still sitting on there.
I have to show you the location.
Okay.
Tires out too.
I don't know if the tires are broken.
Yeah, that's our own track. Clean the place up.
Okay.
I'm not telling you.
I have a question. May I go ahead and dig the underground power? Power company is waiting for me to. I don't know how it affects everything there, but we need power in that building. I'd like to put the trench in.
Which building are you talking about?
Yeah.
We're going to drop down from this hole and supply the power to that building. Let me go home.
How was it proposed originally?
Originally, I believe it went out to the buildings. Not the commission buildings.
Why are you not going to go through the building the way it was originally?
The air conditioning unit requires so much electricity that the original building can't come close to servicing that, plus some of the other lighting and usage of the building out.
Yeah. I'm assuming that Dr. Bob made the power before.
Yeah, I've never heard of this one.
Yeah.
Is that going to be in the front?
Yes, sir.
You going to tear down the building? Probably not.
Well, they got two things right there, it would be. I don't know what my question, my father, if they had to come down, and they're going to put everything in the ground, the depth of that, or I think it's going to be moving compliance, or compliance with,
the electrical inspector has to inspect the open trench. He's waiting, he's on standby for inspecting that trench in the near future if I have the fortune to go ahead.
You will see we have a head of the electric.
Approval of as built, and it seems to me that the closest
better. And so I don't understand why we want to slow fall.
In terms of the stormwater management, it seems to me that the whole point of stormwater management is an integrated plan. That the way that culvert was installed, I'm not an engineer, but even I looked at it, it doesn't look right. It seems to me that it would be better when we have a whole public hearing for the representatives of Woodland to be able to say that the original plan had a culvert removed and a ditch installed here, and that was there now. The original plan had a detention pond along the northeast side of the building. That's installed now. If they were moving further away, they were making changes and were moving further away from what was originally approved, then I say absolutely hold that off until we have a public hearing.
Then we were told the tower, because that was not part of the original plan.
But what I would say is the risk really to the applicant and the contractor is if testimony came forward in the public hearing, let's just say for the channel in the back, somebody came in and was a stream stabilization expert and said, hold on, you need to do X, Y, and Z. That these guys understand the risks associated with moving forward to remove the culvert that wasn't approved anyway, and replacing it with, some channels replacing it with a channel that you may run the risk that somebody shows up and says, we want you to put, some kind of matting in there and persuades the board to approve it. Some kind of
check dam. That wasn't the original plan, but
right.
I guess, Mr. Chairman, do you understand my point about?
I do.
About coming, anything that they can do between now and 2017 is closer to what we originally approved.
But I think that's a good idea, but we're going to say, what will get you closer to what was originally approved than the power line and power to that building has to wait, because that's a serious modification from what we originally approved, which was through the buildings. They're bringing it from a completely different location.
Okay. Let me put it double that again. That's something where if they were building everything else exactly according to the original plans, but they came to the conclusion that they needed to do power lines differently, wouldn't they be able to go to the code enforcement officer and the town planner and say, we need to bring in 400 amp power because of X, Y, and Z, and we can't do it through the building because...
Well, let me check it with the town planner. I don't think they would. I think they'd have to come back. Okay.
Would they
not have to come back with a plan for that kind of change?
We'd ask you guys.
Okay.
In that case...
Well, I unless they give us field change capabilities, we don't take it upon ourselves to do field changes.
Okay.
Only in a situation where you give us the authority
to make field changes. I'm not trying to put any hardship on the plan. Okay. We have understand that, but I think my rationale of allowing construction to get closer to what was originally approved makes sense.
And I think it's a valid point. It does make more sense to say, okay, this is what it was supposed to look like. Make it look like that. But that means that then they can put the ditch in the back. They can put the detention pond on the front, but they can't do the power until after the 27th, until after the public hearing.
Mr. Chair, one quick question.
top to the same.
I don't have that.
I think what transpired, now that we're talking about the power, should I interject, do you want to keep
going? No, please, go ahead.
Originally, it was talked about coming off the first building. Then it revived with the electrical inspector, and quite possibly Jim Nagle, definitely electric inspector, to run overhead to the building directly off of the pole across the street. Then we went ahead and put up the panel, had the inspector out there. Didn't see too much trouble. But the power company comes down and said, we can't put 400 amp wire across the street. It's 11 pounds per foot. And we can't anchor across onto the private property. So we went round and round for about a month, and they went down. It ended up down at the motorland service pole with additional guy wire going in and having to go underground to reach the other building. I'm not the way it's drawn there.
Mr. King, I've got this is from our 2016 application. And there's no indication of where the light power is coming in.
Okay, I was just wondering.
Okay. I actually brought my 2016 folder.
And I couldn't hear all that. So
I actually brought my 2016 folder. Well, not actually. I brought my 2016 folder. There's a drawing on there that does not show where the electric power is coming.
Overhead or underground?
No. Have the tension pod in place set aside other things that they want to do, I would like to give. My motion is that Rutherland be allowed to complete the retention pond and remove the culvert and put the ditch in with the stop check dam. With the check dam, understanding that there is a risk of doing that. But could we have a vote just on that piece?
A motion that they're made seconded to allow Rutherland to go through and put in the retention pond and the drainage ditch in the back of that property, whatever it's called.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
Is that the first motion or the second?
First.
That is the first.
No, the second. Chip, your second revision of the motion, is that the one you want? Would you specify? Because you have two motions.
What?
You have two motions. The first one was just drainage facilities, and then you specified in the second motion. So you want it with specifics?
The first motion that you made, you just dealt with drainage conditions,
right?
And then with the second motion, you elaborated and gave them a specific one. So I think you wanted the second one, but I'm not sure.
It was all one motion, the specific stormwater management, the retention pond, and the ditch, moving the culvert with a check dam at the northern corner of the facility.
And that's what Jamie said?
Correct.
Okay. So that motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? The only thing I would say about this, and it goes to the discussion that started way back in the day, I would say we don't allow them to do anything until after the public hearing on the 27th. Yes, they were supposed to put in it, do all of this originally. They're not the ones who decided to change any of the plans. And I think that they should not be allowed to do any construction work on it until after it has been approved. They come to us and they said, this is what we want to do. And I have no problem with what they want to do, but I think they should be told you have to wait until after this. Until after we have a public hearing and we have a meeting on the 27th.
Drainage pond was part of the original.
Yep, I know that. Like I said, we're not the ones who changed the plans now.
May I say something?
Absolutely.
Months ago, we stopped work. As soon as we could stop work on all these future items, talked to Paul about getting this revised and updated. So I've been at a standstill, I don't know how long, 6 months or something on this, to get it through the process. It's not like we've been out there continually doing things. We're on hold. I mean, the building is finished on the inside, ready for needing to be occupied. And I feel like I didn't continue the violations or ignoring the gentleman. I picked up what Paul had given me as an approved plan. I wasn't at any of these meetings to know. I'm listening to this like I was here and I ignored what you gentlemen gave us permission for. I went ahead and built this awful plan as best I could with everything that was being thrown at me for what was needed out there. And I did have conversations with Paul along the way, so we've got to get this stuff in front of the planning board. Absolutely. And the process of going through everything. Here we are. I haven't done anything out there. I offered the first time I met you gentlemen to rip anything out there. I don't want to be in violation. I want to be cooperative.
We have a motion on the floor. Any other discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 4-1. Motion passes. We can do the ditch and the retention pond.
Utilities.
They should be able to do that because of what's happening.
It's not a change.
What is your opinion?
If it's not under original planning, so it's not a change,
then
we can do it.
Then make a motion.
make a motion that they permit to run the electrical utilities as requested.
Motion has been made. Is there a second?
Yeah.
Motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? 3-2. Case the other. Jay?
Aye. Okay.
3 in favor, 2?
Right.
2 opposed.
No, okay.
One time.
Oh, yeah, no.
How do you do it?
Chip and I will do it.
So I can't do that. Can I take the gentleman's hand that said I can if I can get this thing moving along? I appreciate that.
Very good. 27.
Communicate with the town plan.
Pardon me?
Communicate with the town plan.
Good.
And the code enforcement office.
I have moved my hearing. I'm going to construction on my other picture.
Communicate with the town plan or code enforcement office. Communicate.
Communicate.
Call.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the question is the next question.
that's what I would probably suggest, but is that something that I should even bother asking for approval?
One question I have, this is deciduous, okay? And deciduous means spring, summer, fall, and bare in the winter. We have no budget.
Well, there's 50% of what Bob Metcalf has drawn in there, so it was all his names every fall.
Yeah. Just worry about that. He has that one.
Right.
The question of the board is,
the state just went through there.
We have Hemlock in there, which we what's on here is Hemlock by Burns at the end of the lot 10 against the existing trees.
Oh, lot 10,
yeah.
Lucas just went through there. I got pictures of it too, but I think they just went through there like 3 weeks ago and they completely pruned the right side of the gathering room. So like my natural buffer is, I mean, they've cut 15 feet from the drainage. There's like nothing there anymore. That's the state, and I called the state to ask permission for the buffer. He says, you want to take care of this with the state side? He said, how do it? I don't have the manpower or the equipment to do it.
So just one small place in front of the river?
It looks like it's just like a fur ground cover or a
ground wall.
No, you
think? Then I think that's going to be cool.
Right. I'm more or less just looking for that lilac border. And I would object to spacing the lilacs more and putting, if you guys wanted a fir or hemlock in between for the year-round greenery, I could space the lilacs 6 feet instead of 3 feet.
Or stacked. Yeah. Is that what that?
Edward? There's four homeowners in there now, and they all kind of approach me about a more decorative, flowering hedge, so to speak, as an hedge. That's why I love it.
Edward, refresh my memory as to what the last owner was.
This is what a same shade plant that usually has flowers in the spring. It's not what's done
for a shrub plant.
It can be anywhere from the green gardens there to the
English.
That's what we call it. Arrowheads.
I've got
6 feet to 7 feet tall. They can have a heart shape. The woman's spreading. Some of them have nice colors in the fall, which is nice. And then what else did we add? The white house, that's what you're into.
Right, which is going to drop every leaf on it in the fall. So those are going to be bare stems through the winter.
Stay green, don't worry about it.
It should come, that's what I'm calling it.
slides, it's the slides.
Yeah.
What's that?
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I'm trying to keep the cost down. I mean, Bob's already hit me up to $2,100 on lot one. Now he wants another $2,100 for lot 10. I got a price to go to the best one out of funding, it's just $2,100. So there's another $2,100 on lot 10.
What I would like on lot plus 1 and 10 is a time frame. When are you going to put the work in? When are you going to put the trees in?
I'd like to do it sooner than later, just address it.
So, that part of it, when you drive by and there's nothing in the line, but look at it. He's supposed to be doing some landscaping out here.
Yeah.
Expired or
Pegasus Bridge.
It's
just like Pegasus Bridge. Hold them to relief or die.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, but I'm like...
Because I mean, we talked about it in the context of Marty Ledge.
Yep.
I got an email today.
Yeah, unknowns to the guys, you know, really, I mean, up at, you know, the same situation.
Well, you know, quite frankly, we should have told, we should have told us, you know,
Butt in for a second. Turn it on.
very nice, beautiful berm. I happened to go by it the other day. And it looks to be good enough to even miss the truck sitting in the parking lot.
Yep, I haven't inspected it yet. But then again, I'm not supposed to. The design is different. All right, so, am I supposed to be the reporter?
Yep.
All right. So we have some more applications coming in to us. We have our first pet daycare center coming in on the 27th. I have talked to a negotiator with a gentleman right now who wants to put in an automated ammunition factory here in town.
Good fireworks.
About 4,000 square feet, less than 4,000 square feet, so guess what? We can't rate it. And I got asked, he's looking at the one that Doc Hall holds all the owners, actually the Doc Hall hold owner, wants to put a facility in their offices upstairs, facility there.
You do know that those things blow up, okay?
I do, but I don't have any authority over it right now.
You don't have any authority.
There's a site plan review on that, which is what it was because manufacturers are going to need to use. Site plan review on that requires basically to be 4,000 square feet of change of use, which it hasn't. Or it's a 1,000 square feet or more expansion, or the need for more three or more parking spaces or loading docks. I'm not doing it. I was drop shipping it by FedEx, so it doesn't need a loading dock. It's not using any trailer facility. Give you some ammo to work with here. I'm sorry,
that was a facetious.
But it's a whole other ordinance.
What's the proposed use of the building?
The proposed use is a manufacturer.
So
he's not producing any waste per se. He gets the cartridges, they're pre-made here, and basically it's a propellant with bullets in and ships everywhere.
Yes, tell me about that. I just want to be really clear, sir, before we are, we're not talking about any. No recycled components. Everything new.
New components, I asked him that.
Okay, because
it makes a big difference.
The reason, yeah, because the second you start punching old primers out of cases, you got mercury and.
Yep.
They're all kinds
of. No, it's all new stuff. ATF is obviously all they have to make there. And they don't have an issue.
So he's just going to have.
Not really. It's
just going to be easy to spend $40,000 with Dylan and get one of those hot calendar girls to fire up the presents on.
I think so. He says he can undercut the big boys, federal and so forth, by 30%. Which makes quite a bit of that.
Yeah, sure. Well, there's one up in, I think it's one up in my home. There's another one up in the manufacturing there, too.
Exactly. Motors manufacturing.
When you're manufacturing,
this guy's out of Massachusetts. His son, Jersey, Maine, wants to get home. So I'm searching for
a resident. Are they talking mail order? Are they talking retail? What are they doing?
They're going mail order. They're going direct ship.
Who's the quality control?
I don't know. I asked if you have you had any prototypes tested by Guns and Ammo or any of the other testing? Any of the popular magazines who basically do rating? You know, American Rifle, they rate
reject it, you know, the power, the snow, the hitting power, all this type of stuff. I mean, he didn't seem to be as interested in that as he was in the market. Yeah, I don't know anyone else.
Unless you get the blessing from one of the big reviewers, I would buy it.
Ratings, and not for the bozos online. I want it for one of the big boys. Anyways, that's what's being proposed right now. I've got a couple other things. I've got Norman Rose Subdivision, which is like 15 years old. I took a look at that. It's on the Proctor Road.
Okay.
It's grassed over the whole road. It's practical grassed over. And they wanted to get compulsive permits. They've got them on the list. So, well, first of all, get a letter from the design engineer that it stands. And if not, you have to come back. So it's a plan to approve back in 2001.
Wouldn't you have to come back anyway? That permit expired after a couple of years.
There's a property. Butler Road, you have a permit out there. So there's a house. There's been a house out there for a while. Actually, it's a trailer.
Where's the property? Cross over the railroad tracks and make a right-hand turn all the way.
Yeah. I also have another gentleman who wants to put an elderly housing on the other property. Or there's a lot of that.
That is true.
So all we need are lawyers.
My water's guns in.
So what else do I force is, my lawyer's guns, drugs, and money. Walking in that's my time.
And we have some more, and the selectmen would like to, for Lewis to... Selectmen would like us to revisit a road issue. Private ways again, just don't do it with that. And once again, this is one of the four times this is here.
Yeah.
And we have several other requests that are coming in. And we, I think we're scheduled for the end of August, of course. You were scheduled, and I'm sure.
I just said August 24th.
August 24th, we're going to deal, we're going to get together with the comp plan committee and sit down and start going over the presidential stuff. They're screaming at all these that we're not implementing yet, and we do have to deal with the issue.
What is their issue? The problem?
They want to combine R2 and R3 into one district.
They want us to change, they want us to put an incentive zoning in our four district.
What's an incentive zoning?
Incentive zoning to preserve rural character.
How are they willing to consider 5 acre state lots? Instead of 10?
They're calling for 10 acre.
Yeah.
Here's the issue, that all of their terms have expired. So.
Hey, I forgot to do anyone.
So, all of the terms are required, so they have to be reported. I don't know if there's something we can do about that. We have to deal with this issue.
Let's deal with that in a new point.
That'll be at the end of the month. Same time, these guys are done. And we have a new member.
Oh, this is all?
Yeah.
Who's that?
Yes, I do. But I think I'm not supposed to say it until he accepts.
Okay.
Until it's official.
Okay.
Okay. So I think I'll be on the agenda tomorrow. But he's a lawyer.
I thought he was going to the ZBA.
No, I know.
He's coming over here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's coming to us.
But professionally, I will tell you one thing. If it's the one who I'm thinking it is, okay? He's been on that side of the table before us.
Good, yeah. As long as he doesn't come with an agenda.
Huh?
As long as he doesn't come with an agenda, who cares?
No. No agenda, but I'm just saying, he's jumped through the hoops before, and he knows some of the old...
I was, Mr. Chairman, I was working on putting a survey to mail out with the property tax bills, and because it's cheaper to do that
for
marijuana, yeah, for madness, as opposed to putting it on a ballot, it's about a third the cost.
No, I'd like to put it in the property tax
bill. Okay. And I'll get it out to you and show you what it is. We're basically listing five.
Let's work together.
Okay. I figured I'd let you know because we're talking.
More than the whole place chair.
We're gonna put a section on there for people to put in their property tax number, their lot map, whatever. But then they've got a couple of questions. Are you a resident of Arundel? Do you own property in Arundel? Are you a business?
So if you're sitting in
the real
estate tax,
they could be a business but with something, but not
right.
Living
in
town.
Well, that's the resident question.
Right.
If you're sitting in the village, they're a property.
Right. Yes. So that would be kind of redundant.
Can you have more than one spot to check?
Well,
check.
Time out.
They do, but I don't know any of those people are. So the, unless you want to send a survey to every voter, we're only going to get about 3% back.
Right, 35% back.
Yeah, so if we send out 1,000 and we get more than 30 back, we're ahead of the game.
You're lucky.
That's why I'm not, and that's why I'm not as a man.
Well, but I...
Because I know what the results are. But as we say, unless we put a stamp on it, the only other thing that we would put on the bottom is that we could say you can scan and send an email to us, which a lot of people have a capability to. It's not as easy as just doing a survey. But, you know, it shows that everybody gets one, including, you know, non-residents who are private. Well, we can filter those out.
And make it available perhaps to non-property owning residents to come to the town hall and complete one and put it in the box.
Some of
them. If they, you know, if they're aware.
We're going to miss some people.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you're not here.
And the one thing we want to make sure is that we want to have some folks who come and stack the box. At least they can watch stack the box. Yeah.
Are we responsible for folding the chairs or not?
I'm actually helping because I think they were good enough to set this up.
It's even a mere question.
That is to the select and the money of that.
Almost any other.
Do they review it? Do they select and say they like it? Or they like it? Or just to tell me, you know, that you can work with it?
Nobody has.
I'm just asking.
Make a motion for your chairman.
Yeah.
Now you're officially the chairman.
Okay.
Should go there for now.